Come on. Come on. Start broadcasting. There we go. Everything is live. Here we go. That just means I have plotting to grab. One last set of plots to grab. And that one. That one. All right. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the pre-show. The best, you know, the cold open for the Eve Market Show. The part where you get all of your questions answered, as long as they have to do with our FAQs. I don't tend to have time to go into like a lot of depth, because I'm going to be shuffling between getting the last couple of things done in the plots. And yeah. So hope y'all are having a good day. Hope life out there in internet land is pretty good. Oh, I do need to get a screenshot of the thing from those guys. Okay, Manticore is interesting. Hecate. Oops, no, I want the bombers, please. Put the logic group in there. Let's check our moon goo real quick. Nothing great in there. Good to know. Warp disruption field generator. I don't think we care. Not a lot of flags this week, guys. Well, thank you for the host, Manny. If you guys didn't catch us on Sunday night, I was on Many Bothans is primary, just sort of shooting the shit with, oh god, I always forget his name, but the guy from Eve Onion, and then a bunch of the Just Let It Happen crew. So that was fun. It was great to talk with all those guys. you should go tune in. Just a lot of rambling, so I don't have anything like specific to point out, like, oh, tune in for my expose on something. But yeah. Oh my God, Marshmallow's up. Holy shit. Space trading royalty over here. Isn't it like the ass end of morning over there? Well, welcome at the absolute least. Sorry if I missed you last time. All right. Jeez, there is just nothing interesting in the flags this week. This is the worst part about doing the show. These are the worst days when I go through the flags and I'm like, there's nothing to talk about. We don't have anything in moon mining to talk about. We don't have any big flags to talk about. We're about five slides short of where we usually are. Oh, but we do have. Let me grab the thing. Not that one, this one. Mean, the future of moon mining is interesting, and only in that I have been eating just maximum crow lately because of, I thought that the moon mining changes were coming like in 6 weeks, not in 6 months, 8 months, which really just breaks my stinking heart. What the fuck? Oops. Oh, it's interactive. Shite. Oh, so Marsh is asking, why am I leaving? And just the truth is that life and Eve are not well aligned anymore. I've got stuff that I am working on, and it's getting harder and harder to stay inside the Eve meta. And I'd rather double down on the dev work than show up and give you guys a half-ass show. Because I have a really hard time even logging in anymore. So let's see. A4E review export. Okay. Oops. Nope. I want Mexilon. Oops. Show price forecast. And I mean, I'll never sit here and say that Eve has not been fun and has not been worth the time. It's just that, like, I need to be going and doing other things. Like, I just to be the sort of place I am that I occupy in the meta requires, like, really doubling down on my place in the meta. And I'm doing a shit job of it. Like, I'm really not doing a good enough job to justify my spot. So, I mean, I'll still be around and I'll still keep the Discord open and This isn't necessarily like everything goes cold turkey and see you later, nerds. It was great, not kind of thing. Oops. It's just that I gotta work on other things. Like I said, I have some plans. I have some plans for stuff to come out. We're gonna talk about in the show today that that there is we just released an API this week. This week for sure. I'm trying to do like four things at once. So give me 30 seconds to finish putting graphs together. We're going to do a little bit of hatchet job on these just to get them to fit. Man, the 16:9 ratio is fucking killing me. There we go. Then we're gonna do the layout. Where it's that. Send that to the bottom. Make that. Bold, Roboto. We're gonna bring this up and over. It's a little bit of a hack job, but it's what you get. I mean, like, I said in the blog post, like, who truly honestly quits Eve? But like I said, I got to go focus on some other work, and the dev fleet stuff I still want to keep attached to because there's still a lot of cool stuff going on here, and it's a great data science playground kind of thing. But I can't do this show and work on that. Like, I can't do the show anymore. Like that's what it kind of boils down to. So. It takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of energy, and I'm not in the right meta for you guys. Like I feel like I'm wasting your time. Mexilon, Prosper. Okay, we're gonna say great, but like I'm going through to try and figure out what my going away present is going to be for you guys, and I'm liquidating a bunch of stuff, and I hate it. I played all last weekend, and I hated it. It was so annoying. Like, I was doing all this asset liquidation, and I was just, oh, it was killing me. Just felt so freaking, so many clicks, and it just didn't, the love was gone, man. Freaking sucks. I mean, I love the tool work. Uh, Lord knows I love doing the Devfleet stuff. But oh my freaking god, actually doing the orders. I was like, just throw it all in the incinerator and let God figure it out. Bold over here. We're gonna pop that up a few ticks. There we go. I mean, I want, it's because I need cash. Cash is king, and I've got a bunch of assets that need to just be liquidated. I need to get stuff centralized. Like, it was going to be done fine, but... And like, I'm super excited, for instance, with the... data set we just released that come on, that like, okay, so no, and I'm not gonna RMT it away. I have a present for you guys. I promise long time fans of the show will appreciate it. Even if it seems that I've burned like half of the bridges on my way out with, some of my older friends, RIP Hydrostatic 5 Eva. Words are hard. So like we just released a big, the big predictor, endpoint for guys, and it should be live on Adam for Eve next week. It's right now on their dev branch. You can go check it out, but it's and we'll talk about this in the show. And I should just save this for the show, but like I honestly believe after watching Adam for Eve's validation of our data set, he's been running for 2 weeks on our data, and he's been caching his own copy of it, that the we have the that tool is like two or three times more powerful than I expected it to be, that the quality of the predictions that are coming out of it are good enough that if you were working in a core basket sort of thing, you could really work out you could really get ahead of like two to 3 weeks of stuff, and if you hedged your bets so that you had a diverse sort of sampling, so that you knew you were going to lose on maybe 20% of your items, and the wins would wash out the losses several times over, and you could basically just play like a mutual fund, coming in and getting out of positions over time with like 2 week with 2 week positions. And I should just save this for the show because I'm wasting my time. We're running late anyway, so. Excuse me. So just a quick rundown before we start the show. I'm your host, Lock Fox. This is the Eve Prosper Show. We're going to start here in like 5 minutes. The show runs about 45 minutes. I don't tend to answer questions during the show, but I do have chats open on everything. So I do get your comments and questions. If we didn't get to your comment and just hold out till the end, we do a 30-minute Q&A afterwards, where I'm more than happy to answer your questions, because if you guys give me questions, I can give you answers. Otherwise, I'm going to rant about Devfleet stuff, and You'll never get, you know, we'll just talk about how much I love Python. And sometimes that's fun, but like, I think you guys deserve better. The show, every plot on the show is hand generated. We use R to generate the plots. We have a Python backend feeding all the data. You can check out all the data sources in the links down below, should be on the thing. And if you want to join us, if you want to get in touch with me after the show, the best place to do so is through our Discord. Now, everybody who might be coming back to the show understands, like, if you're brand new to the show, you may not have heard. We are running up to retirement. The show will end in early June. We're going to hit episode 100, and it's got to be time for me to retire. So I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry if this is your first show. But, you know, real life comes first. So with that, there is still lots of DevFleet stuff. So if you're looking to learn Python, if this data science stuff is interesting to you, if you want to talk market stuff, and if you are even coming into this and thinking, I don't understand markets at all. This whole space economy thing is way too complicated for me. And come on, Geronica. No. Don't do that. Feel free to ask your questions. I do try to make this accessible to everyone. I know that there's tons of PvPers out there who may think that they aren't smart enough for this, or they don't want to make all the spreadsheets. And honestly, I don't think you need a whole ton of spreadsheets. Like, the spreadsheets help. They help you get more stuff done and keep track of stuff. And like, it doesn't take a turbo nerd. You can tune your gut, and I'm going to be here to try and help you tune your gut and at least make your bad posts slightly better. So with that, looks like it's about time to start the show. I'm going to press some here to get the recording started, and we are going to make this happen. Last thing, if you are watching us, we are simulcasting both to YouTube and Twitch. The YouTube stream is at 1080 glorious HD, so you can get all of the pixels with your graphs. The Twitch one, less so. I am reading both chats. I am watching all of the things. I've got all the windows open. It's a total freaking mess over here. So do get subscribed. Do get that stuff done, and we will get the show rolling. So that button. And then that button. Good evening, and welcome to another episode of the Eve Prosper Market Show. I am your host, Locke Fox, and I'm here with all of the market news that you need going into the weekend so you can go make mad money. Trademark, please, Jim Cramer, do not sue me. But let's start where we always do, the part that I know all of you YouTube scrubbers just love, the part where I explain what's going on behind the scenes on the show. So number one, if you haven't got the news yet, the show does have a drop dead date. We are shooting for episode 100 to be our final show. That doesn't mean that we will all go quietly into that night. It just means that I cannot keep up the show any longer. Now, I love all of you guys who have tuned in, everybody who has tuned in live, and everyone who has helped contribute, whether from bad post to code, have really made this show possible. And I got to thank all of you, but all good things come to an end. There will be more news on our way out, so don't turn that dial. Do keep subscribed. There will be more stuff coming down the pipe. after when we come back in the autumn. Maybe not Eve-centric, but if you like the graphs and you like the data science stuff, you should stick around. Number two, if you aren't following the blog, you totally should at eveprosper.com. We just released our beta for our new endpoint, our profit endpoint. This is a REST service that predicts the future. It's super skookum and is right now powering predictions at both EveMogul and AdamForEve.eu. If you are a dev and you want to get your hands on this, you should call me because it requires an API key. Just because it's so CPU intensive, it requires, you know, we got to put a little bit of a gate on it. But I'm more than happy to share the data with interested parties. There'll be more news about that coming up. We're trying to finalize some things. One thing I'm trying to avoid, though, at the moment is it is just not well suited for Google Docs work at the moment. So sorry, spreadsheet warriors, blame Flask. We're working on a solution for that. There's a couple of pieces coming together, and hopefully in the next 4 to 6 weeks, we might actually have a release that is stable enough for you Google Docs warriors. Next, if you want to follow the show, all you got to remember is Eve Prosper. That'll get you to Twitch, Twitter, YouTube, and our blog. We broadcast live on the internet at 0300 Fridays. That's Thursday night US on both Twitch and YouTube. And you can tune in live. If you can't catch us live, don't worry. We do stream straight to YouTube and it is available as soon as the show stops. So you can get all of that great stuff, everything you need to know, all of the wonderful graph pornography. Next order of business is that, yes, we do have a Patreon. It is staying open until the final episode. What does your patronage buy? Your patronage helps keep our servers online into perpetuity. We are working very hard to get all of the pieces together so that like the new endpoint we just launched is ready to go to Cloudflare if all things fail out. We're right now hosted in on a private server at Random Boy's home, who has been so gracious to give us the space. But we are working on distributed solutions so that nothing gets lost. We're working on archives so that you guys can get access to some of our bulk data, and all of that is helped by our patrons. If you get value from the show, if you appreciate what we've done, do chip in a buck. It goes an incredibly long way. You guys would not even believe just how far the Patreon money goes. But if you can't support us, if you won't support us, that's totally fine. Do get subscribed, though. We do like seeing numbers going up and to the right. And though this Prosper show is coming to an end, there will be more coming up, hopefully, in the fall. We're looking to get into more of an IRL, real market bend. If you enjoy our data science and our graph pornography, you should stay subscribed because there will be stuff. We're going to go through a whole rebranding, and maybe I'll just pull my head out of my ass and realize that Eve is the greatest thing ever after a summer of failure. So we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens overall, but do get subscribed, do follow us. And if you want to get in touch with me, if you want to talk about the market, the very best way to do so is through our Discord. Links are down below in the doobly-doo. With that, I think that's been enough show spam. Thank you everybody who tuned in live. We have a great turnout tonight. We should get right on with the show. So I should press the right buttons. That's the right button. So first, you remember that profit endpoint I was talking to you about? So right now we are looking at charts from AdamForEve of Mexilon, darling of the show. And this is on the top is the general, AdamForEve does a great breakdown of all of the sort of stats you'd want for any individual item. I really love the way that they profile every item. I'm especially a fan of the buy and sell depth chart down at the bottom. But thanks to our endpoint, we are providing them future oops, need my fancy smancy laser pointer. We're providing them future predictions about the price of Mexilon in the future. The other thing that Ethan over at Adam for Eve went ahead and did is he is storing the predictions he gets and is checking our work. And as you can see, the behavior is surprisingly good. Like, okay, so if you've done linear, we're not quite out of the range where a linear predictor may have been just as good. But the fact that we've been staying on the line like 80% of the time and staying in the bounds 95% of the time, like, holy crap, color me impressed. This to me reads great for speculators, especially if you wanted to build out a diverse portfolio week to week, where if you put enough of these things together and you picked out some of the shining examples, you could still take losses on maybe 20% of the items, like either even or losses, let's say, and then the rest of your portfolio makes up all the gains and eliminates whatever losses you would have made. So I have a hard time telling you to take this to the more fringy markets. Like, I wouldn't use this on high meta. I have a hard time believing in this on a lot of the manufactured goods, but I love this for a lot of the core basket items, your minerals, your PI, your fuel, all of those kind of things. And I think this is a great opportunity to really get ahead of the EVE market meta with some Skookum tools. So really, I am floored. I didn't expect it to be this good, but that's where we are. Next, EVE Mogul is our other partner right now, and he is extending our current OHLC charts on EVE Mogul. So you do need to be subscribed to EVE Mogul to get access to this, but for your subscription fee, EVE Mogul has amazing accounting software, which if you're a fan of the show for any length of time, you will know that I harp so bad on accounting and just how important it is to have, to make sure that you're counting your gains and your losses. And so it's been incorporated into the OHLC feed. We'll see how that ends up going. I don't know if he has a great way to display a lot of the numbers or do a lot of the decisions for you, but I'm a fan of this one because not only can you mix your technical analysis, your traditional technical analysis, especially things like the RSI down here, you get the both of them, chocolate in your peanut butter kind of thing. So like I said, we're up on Adam for Eve and Eve Mogul. If you are a dev and you did not get a key and you would like one, do get in touch with me. We can get you one rolled up pretty quick. And just got to go through a couple little terms of service because, well, I mean, this is a hobby project and there's a machine learning backend that will destroy the server if we just let you go whole hog into it. So we just have to talk for a second, but we can get you an API key. You can get to the races. So with that, now that I have bored all of you guys for the last 15 minutes with everything not the market, let's talk about Plex. So Plex was staying steady for the last few weeks, but is now trending back up again. It's been it's been particularly flat for the last couple of weeks, but now we're breaking out of the 120 regime. The interesting piece to me is just how thin the volume is at the moment, and we're heading towards over high territory here according to the RSI. So it's just that it's a really weak market. There's not a whole lot of people playing in it, and this is causing things to go a little bit wonky. I think that a lot of people are holding patterns ahead of the Plex split on May 9th. So I'm of two minds for that. So on the one hand, you're trying to catch a falling knife and say, well, I expect the Plex split to dump the prices, and therefore I want to get the highest possible price and I want to get out of there. Or number two, you disagree with me entirely and you think the Plex split will just, amp the market entirely. I disagree entirely with that thing, but you can bet against me. Why not? And you're just sort of waiting it out. And then the third, I guess, would be that I don't really need cash for right now. I'm just going to let Plex ride until I need it, which really is the better part of valor in this case. Zooming all the way out, we are reaching towards that record high again. Actually, I think the record is 135, and we're just above 12, almost to 125. Again, we're going hot and fast. We're starting to get into unstable territory, but it's not quite off the rails yet. It's but like I'm thinking crash here. Like I think we're gonna go back to 1 billion as soon as the RM comes back on the market. From 1.2, that's a big fall. It's hard to say you're gonna lose, 20% of the market. But the ability here to jump in and jump out, I think that we're going to lose maybe 10%. It's really hard to say 20%. Like saying a 20% decline in Plex, like that's Black Friday levels here, right? Like, okay, that's 17% or something. But yeah, the Plex split comes, I think we're going to be back at 1.1 at the least, and I think that into the summer we're going to sag into a billion or just under. I'm just not seeing, well, demand might be funky. Unless we have a big war, then all bets are off. Next, zooming in, what we can see is that the buy pressure has really dropped. Big set of market orders have dropped out of contention. Now, this doesn't include the Citadels, unfortunately. But we just see really low volumes on the market, and that's leading to growth. This is a pretty standard pattern. You're under the median, you tend to go up. Over the median, you tend to go down. So, I mean, Eve needs a big fat war, but that would involve people getting off their asses instead of just carrier ratting, so and super ratting. Zooming out to the rest of the RMT items, which I think I'm going to remove this plot going forward. Not a whole lot to say here. And skill trading, the margins continue to eke together. What we see is that a steady injector price and a rising Plex price is causing the zombie margin to really get squeezed here. We're down to 100 ISK per skill point bonus margin here. I have a hard time believing they're going to crash into each other. I'm just wondering why we don't have the cost reflected yet. Zooming back in, we can see the volumes are a little on the thin side, like just on the other side of median, in my opinion, means that we should be just above 700 million if everything was going perfect. But the prices are tracking down at the moment, and they have not picked up the way we have expected them to. Looking across the rest of the market at our indexes, not a lot to say here. We saw a dip during FanFest. But we're coming back to normal. Not a lot to say here, except that the mining efficiency seems to be really taking a toll. We were seeing a lot of efficiency still after the Rorke nerf, but now that everybody's coming back to Eve since FanFest, perhaps the pressures on Rorke mining are finally taking it out of the hands of every Joe Schmo and putting it back down to regular industrial levels. So it's getting to be interesting. Now, the thing I love to see is that we've been on a downswing in ships, but are finally starting to recover, which is great news in my opinion. We'll see when we zoom in on the total destruction that that's corresponding to a value destroyed uptick, which is great to see. This last 3 or 4 weeks has been rather disappointing, in my opinion. Ahead of FanFest, there was just a lot of lull, and the value destroyed is going up. Now, part of this could be the mining drones getting added to the kill mails is definitely a part of this, but like we're talking about hundreds of billions of ISK getting destroyed to move this line up, and well, I don't expect 100 billion ISK per day of mining drones to be destroyed. Like a couple billion, absolutely. 5 to 10, maybe 5 billion a day, but I wouldn't expect to see more than 5 or 8 billion ISK worth of mining drones to be destroyed on any given day. But it's good to see. I would like to see more super capital losses, which do not show up on this list, but we seem to be derping capitals at a reasonable rate if reports are to be believed. Moving on to minerals, we go look at all of the stuff that makes all of this stuff. We start in tritanium. Tritanium is trending up. We were saying for the last few weeks that expected it to stay steady at 4.5. I know this looks like an upward trend, but we're talking about this bar is from 4.0 to 4.5, so it's not a lot of change. Zooming in on the market, we've seen the supplies start to subside just a little bit. I would go ahead and change my prediction for a 5.0. It's tempting here to buy a sub 4.5 buy order and sell for a 5, but this is I don't like speculating in tritanium. It's an expensive market, and the margins are razor thin. So you really need a ton of money and a ton of patience to really make some money in this market. The volumes are subsiding slightly and are looking to trend a little bit lower if all of the other trend lines we're seeing are to be believed. But yeah. Oh, and we still haven't seen this March's econ numbers. I thought they were going to get released on Wednesday, and they did not. So I got to go yell at Quant. Can't believe I forgot about that. CCP Quant, call me. Moving on to pyrite. Pyrite is staying steady just under the 6.0 mark. Not a lot going on. Volume's a little bit low. And supplies are staying steady and strong. So I think we'll continue to be in this 5.5-6.0 regime going forward. Not a whole lot of action going on here. Not a whole lot to report. We might see a little bit of roll-off in the orders down under 7.5 billion. But I don't think that's enough to really move the price in any significant way. Moving on to Mexilon. Mexilon is our darling. And if you were watching the plots from before, Mexilon is poised to take a jump. Now, though I agree with the sentiment that over 80 and maybe over 90, Mexilon is a distinct possibility. I have a hard time jumping on the thing and saying, oh, well, it's going to happen in the next 4 weeks. What the machine is predicting and the reality of Eve, I don't think are gelling together quite well. It would really require some churn in the capital markets to start putting more pressure on Mexilon. With as much peacetime production as is going on, we could end up with that spike. I just have a hard time believing that it's going to arrive on what May 18th or something that it says on the plot. So though I agree with the what, I have a hard time agreeing with the when, but we'll see. Maybe the machine is smarter than I am. Wouldn't be the first time. Zooming in, actually, I should have said this before zooming in. volumes are getting pretty tight, so we are in a spot where it could pop. So here I go, and I talk for 2 minutes saying one thing and then come back into the next graph, say the opposite thing. Like I said, I've been telling you guys to buy sub 75 for a few weeks now, and like this weekend is your last chance to get in on that train. I'd be shooting for an 85. The graph is predicting 100. I have a hard time really saying 100, but we're getting towards divide by zero territory here. So the price here could get unstable fast. So if you're watching right now and you were just thinking to yourself, oh, I wonder if I should buy something and actually do what Lockfox says, like, pause the show. We'll be back when you're done. You can catch up on YouTube two times speed. And go buy Mexilon, because this is a great opportunity. Next, Isogen, the one that I have no love for and continue to shit on week after week, continues in its 50 to 55 regime. Not a lot to say here. Again, volume's pretty lean. Supplies just keep cranking up. And this says to me that there is a lot of high sec mining going on right now. A lot of this has to do with the Ombery balance that was, 9 months ago. Changing that ISK per hour meant that there's a lot more Isogen in the system, and it just keeps going up and up and up and up, and we just don't have the stuff to consume it and get it out of the system. So I think prices are on their way down. Like, if you could short it, this would be a great chance to short, but life. Next, Noxium. Now, I could have sworn last week, and I'm going to have to go through the tapes again to double check, that Mexilon Noxium was in a spot where I was like, if you wanted to gamble, this isn't a bad gamble. And oh my God, it's actually paying off. We were at 3.6 and now we're at 400. Again, that divide by zero phenomenon I kept telling you guys about. The supplies got so thin that the price spiked, supplies rushed in. We're tracking back down pretty hard. And actually, this would be a great chance, if you believe in lightning striking twice, to go put in a buy order at the 350 line, maybe even a little bit lower. Again, live here on the show, your mileage may vary, that we could be back over 400 this weekend. Now, the way that the volume is going, I could see it going both ways. It's a little hard to predict from where we're sitting right here. And we could go way up in supply and just drown it out, and you'd eat it and you'd be back at 350 and go, oh, Lockfox lost me all that money. Or we dip back down again, and we get another pop over the 420 mark every day. I think this is actually halfway decent place to speculate in, especially if you can get in this 350 or under line. There's a lot of space to jump on this market and make a quick buck over the weekend, over the next 4 to 5 days, and be out of it before next weekend. Next, another perennial darling that I love to shit on is Zydrine. And Zydrine is holding steady like a rock at 1K. And I think that this is an interesting to see that volumes are getting a little manipulated, I believe, that we should really be at this 250 million mark for supplies. And I think that somebody's just trying to make sure that it stays high enough so that they don't lose their shirt. This really reads to me like somebody just sort of holding up the market on their own shoulders. And I mean, there is like 50 million units missing from the market, so I don't know if it's truly like a pro bag bear grade market troll, but this is a I think that about half of this is not real at the moment. And the price, I think, is still going to fall. So if you're holding it up, I'm really sorry. You're going to have a bad time. Next, Megasite was tracking down to 1,200, but suddenly popped up over 1,300. Zooming in. Sorry, that was a little too fast. Not a lot going on here. Everything looks relatively normal, but supplies are staying very steady. So I don't know what is driving the price spike, because we didn't lose that many units. So I think that aiming for 1.2 coming in is going to be the trend going forward. I would not, if you bought in and you have a decent margin to sell at 1.3, I'd get out at 1.3. But there is, I think that down is another trend here. Next, Morphite, another darling of the show. I need to stop using that line because I've said it like five times. That has been weak, super weak, and I was complaining about it last week, And then when I went on Manny Bothans, I did mention that if you put on your tinfoil, economic tinfoil, and you think about the new drilling platforms, what I believe is going to happen is that we're going to effectively double the amount of moon goo that gets out to the market. Now, that's just gut feeling. That's just saying the amount of material required, like from active players, expecting them not to put out double the stuff, I think is grossly underestimating the true oper the operational efficiency of space nerds and industry. And that meant that, and then I went on a big long diatribe about if you cut the price of moon materials in half and the price of Tech 2 fell in half, that you'd start to have some really interesting decisions from an FC position to say, well, I've been writing off Tech 2 because it's just so expensive and the options are so much better across the board. Like, why would I bring a hack when I can bring Macarials? Why would I bring all sorts of other ships when there are Tech 1 and faction variants that are just as good and half the price? And furthermore, if you continue down that line, like what if things like Marauders were half price and things like Black Ops were half price? Would we see more of them on the battlefield? Can you think of a Marauder small gang, medium gang, large gang that you'd like to work with? I'm not enough of an EFT warrior to really tell you yay or nay, but it's definitely an interesting what if scenario. And so the corollary to all of that, to all of that speculation and all of that, if you believe me on all of that, then the second order thing that you need to worry about is I don't think that the supply of Morphite will rise, which means if twice as many Tech 2 get produced and the Morphite supply stays the same or only increases maybe 10 or 15%, Morphite's going to pop real hard if I'm actually right. Now, I have a hard time believing that I got on the show and then the markets did what I said they would do. Like, I just don't believe in my Jim Cramerness enough to say that that's particularly the case. Right now, you can just say that, well, nobody listens to Lockfox, but the volumes are low, and that could again be have some mix between people at FanFest and less mining fleets out there and general regular market stuff going on. If you have it, if you can sell it 10K, like sell it this weekend. You know, here's a great chance to jump off at 10, maybe 11K and cash out that particular bet, because I think that if you do sell now, you'll have another chance to buy in by the end of the summer. Like, since we're not going to see the drilling platforms until the fall or winter, I think there's another market cycle between not going to war. That means you can go buy a bunch at like sub 9.5 and look like a genius and sell at 15 or 20 in at the end of the year. But this is a lot of tinfoil. That is a huge castle in the sky to build. So if you don't jump on this particular train ride with me, I completely understand. I just thought, like, if I were going to put in a really long bet, I would want sub 9K Morphite, and I'd be aiming to double the price. If we get there, maybe not. Like, I have just as much, if not more, chance to be wrong. But buying at 9K still gives me the space to be wrong and not lose my shirt. Because if that doesn't happen, if Tech 2 stays the same price and they manage to land things perfectly, and that like Tech 2 maybe only falls or gains in 10%, then like what's the worst that happens? I have 9K Morphite and I sell at 10K or I sell at 9.5. Like, I still make my taxes and fees back. So it's like you have this chance to double your money, and you have such a low chance to lose any money. Like, that is not a bad gamble. It just means that you're sitting on it for 9 freaking months. So, moving on to fuel, now that I have explained probably poorly my particular speculation, let's go on to fuel. So, a couple of weeks ago, when the drilling platform information was released, I had put out a prediction that I expected all isotopes to coalesce to 750 or 800. And so we're seeing decline in the nitrogen topes, and we're seeing increase in the oxygen topes, but things are still staying flat in the helium and hydrogen. I had said this because they mentioned in the dev blog that with moon mining pauses going away, they're going to supplement the isotope consumption by putting it into the new reactions, which is great, whatever. The problem was that I expected, when I made that prediction, I expected moon mining to come out in June, and it's probably going to come out in November. So, I think there's a lot of time for this to play out. There's still a lot of time for traditional moon miners to, moon mine and do all their goodness. So, I find it interesting that Galente continues to be strong in this regime. So if you jumped on this bandwagon and made money, then good. But I don't think that your last chance to jump in on the hype train isn't going to come until like Eve Vegas. So I wouldn't worry too much. Next, fuel blocks, things are staying steady exactly as you expect. I kind of expected Galente to be a little higher and Caldari to be a little lower, but margins are healthy and not a whole lot to say here. Things are looking pretty decent. Strontium, this is our canary in the coal mine for Nullsec warfare. There was a lot of hair pulling this last week. I want to say it was Brave or Test was having a big fight. Ah, jeez. See, this is why I just can't keep up with the null metas anymore. There was a little bit of fighting, and there was a little bit of constriction thanks to, FanFest. But we're going to be back to our regular prices. Not a lot going on here on the volume, so I'm not seeing anybody gearing up for a big sov war. Heavy water, interesting to see a huge buyout, which if you're watching this live is another good chance to jump in. Try to aim for a 350 sell with a 250 buy. There's a big hole in the market at the moment. I don't know who decided to buy out 100 million units of this stuff, but good on you. And so let's go ahead and move on to Outliers. Starting where we always do with advanced materials, not a lot going on. Some of the carbonides are being interesting, but those are inherently unstable and tend to run into some walls. The otherwise, everything is looking really steady. There was a little bit of play on the high end of moon mats, but not enough to really bring up the charts. Like the metamaterials again is looking a little thing, doing a little bit of dancing, and the stuff in the middle, your hypersynaptic fibers, and I want to say nanotransistors, are showing upward trajectories. But like, there's just not a lot of action here that I can really hang a good prediction on. Zooming out to PI4s, again, eating crow on the when do we see the new moon mining. I was saying, stock up, get out in 6 weeks, but seeing as it's not coming for a while, I wouldn't really worry about it. I think that if you've got stocks, I might unspin them and move them to something else. When you get your off ramp might take a few weeks. I can't really tell you when, but like I would unspin some amount of my positions in these if I was holding, and just move into something that has a little bit better volatility and provides a little more action for my money. Next, interesting this week, bombers got bought out, a big spike in manticores, but not the rest of the other flavors of bomber. So this says to me that somebody's just doing a either somebody's just a huge Manticore fan, or some other big solo buyout, this doesn't read to me like big stock up, unfortunately. Maybe it's Kaldari, maybe it's the Kaldari faction warfare guys stocking up on their level four level four farming ships. Next, large auxiliary nanopump twos have taken quite a slide and look like they're going to continue to fall. Not exactly sure why or how, just that it was interesting. Usually, like, the volumes in the market are pretty lean. We're talking 20 units a week, 20 units a day. So it may not be a whole lot to say about it, but it is tracking down pretty hard. You could grab on for auto overcorrection, but I don't know if you'll really make your money out of that one. Next, moving on to prediction review, where we figure out if I know what the hell I'm talking about or if I'm just full of shit. Logistics cruisers, we've been watching really closely the last few weeks. We saw a big buyout of Basilisks right ahead of FanFest. Probably some big operation that I don't have the details on, unfortunately. Oniros, though, taking a big jump up. I didn't think that... I thought the Oniros was out of favor, but perhaps people need Kaidi armor doctrines now? Like, what's the deal with that? Usually our big guys are the Scimitar if you wanted to do kites, and Guardians if you wanted to do bricks, maybe with Basilisk to taste. The Oniros use is really great in small gangs, it's a really fringe meta. So I don't know why it's spiking so hard. Next, the Fenrir flagged last week, taking a big dive, despite the trends in minerals, and has recovered some of its price. It might still have a little bit of room to grow. But without having access to the bill of materials right here, right now, it's hard to tell you exactly where we're going. If it's going up any higher, it's going to be 1 or 2 percentage points. So if you were jumped in, now's a good chance to jump out. And then last, but certainly not least, our violence report, where we look at how many Ishtars and Makarials and Rattlesnakes died this week, because this graph doesn't change week to week and it's really starting to bum me out. We get to see the big Makarial whelps, and we keep seeing the same mix week over week. We still see the Ishtar, the Gila, the Makarial, the Rattlesnake. Rorqual, though, making a comeback this week. Interesting to see those dying, especially since they're supposed to have a panic button. What kind of nerd loses their Rorq, right? Interesting to at least watch that. Next, active systems. Not a lot to say except for VTAC 3. Big hot system last week. Otherwise, everything is looking relatively normal across the board. Big losses in Jita last weekend, though. Next, looking at our region report, not a lot to say here. Black Rise and Citadel and Forge, always on the list. Catch and Placid, not really surprising. So not a whole lot going on here. With that, I'm going to go ahead and wrap up the show. I am your host, Lockfox. This has been the Eve Prosper Show. If you enjoy what we do, do get subscribed. Do share with your friends. We do this show live through the power of the internet on Friday nights, 0300. That's Thursday night U.S. time. You can tune in. Oh, don't tell me it muted. I will be so mad if it muted. No, we're good. Okay, so where was I? See, you get my groove off, and I can't keep it going. So, tune in live if you guys want to join the show. If you can't tune in live, we do stream straight to YouTube, so you guys can go check out the show as soon as it's done. If you have questions, if there is market stuff, if you want to tell me that I either earned you all of the money or lost you all of the money, do join our Discord. Links to join are down in the doobly-doo below. Last and certainly not least is that we do have a Patreon. The Patreon does keep this show on the air ad-free and helps us developing. I know that, again, we are running into retirement, but the money does go towards keeping the services running in perpetuity so you guys can continue to use and count on the tools here at Prosper. This is has been a labor of love, and I do want to keep it going as long as humanly possible, and the patrons are helping us keep that secure into the future. With that, I'm going to go ahead and end the show. I want to thank everybody who tuned in live. I have been your host, Locke Fox. This has been the Eve Prosper Show, and I will see you all next week. And okay, so a couple of moments. Now we have a 30-minute Q&A after the show. If you guys have questions, feel free to put them in the chat. Marsha and Jeronica went ahead and were very active in the Twitch chat, let's say. Solomon, if you want an API key, you're going to have to come onto our Discord and PM me. It'll just take a minute to talk about, how it works, what it works. I just want to check in with whoever I'm giving API keys because I don't have an automated system for it yet. Let's see. Let's see. Am I missing anything? Mirage saying that Plex are going to crash. I agree. It's Morphite is hitting a wall at 10k right now. I think we could hit 11 if, things got shocked, but I wouldn't bet on it. Let's go. Marsha giving me crap for hard time. Gotta talk to Reevra. I will talk to Reevra. We want a March Econ report. I want a March Econ report. All right. We should put this back to here so we have shiny stuff. Again, feel free to ask any questions in the chat. I didn't see anything. Sven was asking, groups are planning for AT, but does AT really affect the market? I only believe that AT really affects the Plex market the hardest, especially in the bidding stages. But the supply chain for AT is so weird that I think the biggest buys of it happen during the tournament rather than any particular stocking up ahead of time. And to everyone asking, can I have your stuff? No, you can't have my stuff. It has been claimed. It is going to... Actually, you can... I lied. You can have my stuff. If you submit a pull request on our API tools, on our GitHub, for an issue that we have outstanding, I pay Plex for those, and I intend to keep paying Plex for those. So, that is a way to get... Sven. That's not happening. but yeah, if you submit PRs, I pay Plex. We have my system admin is doing some amazing work this week, getting us the bugs we ran into for the beta have been, you need a robots.txt. Didn't even freaking think to do it. So today I learned we're going to try and make it so that we can deploy multiple containers or at least start heading towards something Dockery Kubernetes so that we can spin up multiple instances and load balance. But to do that, we have to get a shared cache. So we're working on getting Mongo set into the thing. That should be done soon. I'm working on getting the Plex split covered over the thing. And the next big project on my plate, which I don't know if I'm going to get to before, I don't know if I'm going to get to show you guys before we go off the air, is I think I know I said this almost a year ago, but I think I finally have my head around a better data science pipeline. And I really want to just double down on Mongo, and that's the next big thing. So, how are bid-ask margins doing in general? Collapsing, expanding, more participants in market PvP. So Echoversky, the best tool I have seen, the one that I really enjoyed was Adam for Eve does a great profile that shows the bid and ask depth for every item. And that's an extremely powerful tool on an item-to-item basis to really look at the things. And if you're interested in that, I would look there. As for our margins getting tighter or looser over time, I don't see a general trend. Like, I'm not seeing any like sky falling, it's just harder to make a buck kind of thing going on. But it ebbs and flows, and it's kind of why the so for all of the more casual market people who might be stupefied by some of the intimidated might be a better word by a lot of the market PvP. This is why the target margin I have for almost anything is 10%. If you can't make 10%, you probably shouldn't do it. It's a tool that it allows you to have a little bit of slack in the line so that if things go really like it makes you look for better deals and it makes you avoid the biggest pitfalls. And so even if two lines cross and you're like, well, I bought in a good buy order expecting 10% and the market turned the other way, I can still sell at the minimum loss or maybe even just a tiny bit of profit because I was looking for 10% and that crash might eat my 10%, but it's really hard to lose more than 10%. So that's at least when I'm trying to highlight actions. Now, I go for 10% because having more cash in the system, I can't just always get the 20-25% I'd like to get. But if you're station trading and you're just looking to buy and hold and just, you know, move shells around when it comes to staying in Jita, 10% is not a bad margin to be aiming for. Because to be honest, like if you're just doing station trading and you're not using a Citadel, like you got to worry about 4% for fees, and you gotta worry about if the market turns against you. If you're doing arbitrage on top of it, like go ahead and bump that up to 15% at least to go do that. And I have some other ideas for arbitrage, but I never got to distribute visualizations for it. That's the way I feel on those. So, the point is more that you should always be trying to get more. Like you always want the big, you want the big fish. You want 50%, you want 25, you want 100 if you can get it. But like I see so many players, especially younger, newer ones, get in there and say like, oh well, I'll just build fuel blocks and I'll make, you know, 7% or something. I'm thinking to myself, are you really counting your fees at your POS or whatever or your Retaru? Are you really counting the freight time that you're doing? Because you're really like you're starting from a really thin margin, and if the market turns, you don't have a lot of skid room to not get screwed by. So, that's why it's why I'd rather aim larger, just because it gives more room for slop. And like you want to like why lose? Why would you have to lose when you can get bigger wins, when you can get bigger gains without having to, like, for zero extra effort. And Marja, 1v1 at the sun. Let's go. We'll just throw ISK at each other. You probably have more than me though, so I'll lose that. Money fight. So, yeah, words and stuff. And I got pinged about a thing, Susie. What is Susie's key? Do I have Susie's key? Oh, I'm going to get on the frickin' thing. Words and stuff. Oops. Nope. That goes there. I am a professional streamer and I know what all of the buttons on my thing do. I am good at this. That's not the right one. That's not the right one either. That one. More public cache. Sven with quote of the day, tits sell, fits don't. All right. So, not seeing more questions. Again, this is your chance. Pick the brain. I can tell you how to make mad money. Spoiler, it's work. Nothing is free. Everything is effort. Everything is a gradient. Oh, wow. All right. So, asking about the Astro Houses. I haven't been tracking them, so I can't really talk about them. So Sven is asking if I got to be CCP Lockfox, what would I do to make what major revisions need to be done? To be honest, a robust credit system I think is what the market desperately needs. The incremental pieces of there's a couple other incremental things that I'd like to see, like a more dynamic fee structure when it comes to updating orders, so that when you're one isking, like there are better decisions to make. But that's a thing. Privatizing insurance kind of goes in hand with credit. But credit is such a huge problem because enforcement. I had some ideas for making a credit agency where you leverage the player stats API that Quant showed off like 2 years ago, and pair that up with maybe some post history stuff to build credit ratings. And but you still need a backing bank, and you need enough collateral for it to be sort of pointless. The other thing is that I kind of wanted Brain Meat to be collateral, like be able to use your own skill points as collateral. But that would require that you get perfect reinjection, which sort of breaks one of the points, like to pull it out and then not pay a penalty on reinjection. It just means you're basically paying a respec fee. But yeah, I think I from so some of the stuff I've seen IRL for it, and I think that if we increased the time resolution on the activity feed, I think you get darn close to a credit rating. But like in my perfect world, you use skill points for collateral, and you give players enough tools to audit each other, and I think that actually gets us really close. I'd like to be able to do shorts, and more dynamic bets on the market, because one of the things that really frustrates me about this show is that when I see a price falling, there's not a lot of action to do about it. Like you're like, oh well, I better get out of it. There's no aggressive play on a short. So well, and like I have some design notes for credit rating. And it's not just a people Lockfox likes thing. Like there was some NLTK work I really wanted to go do. Like that would, oh my God, that would jazz me so much, as if I had an NLTK project that actually could use Eve. Natural language processing in Eve would be totally would totally get me jazzed again and have me continuing the show. But like I'm not teaching a robot to understand Reddit shitposting or forum shitposting. Like those are both useless endeavors in my opinion. Like, I'm just gonna go make another Hitler bot, and Microsoft did a better job at that than I do. So, but and I'm really, really disappointed with the how long we have to wait for the moon mining thing to come out. Like, that's a So, long-time fans of the show will know that we take the summer off. It's because there's really nothing for us to talk about over the summer. Even if Imperium goes to war and we see a repeat of the Fountain War style thing, that doesn't drive enough volatility in the market to justify the horsepower we put into it. That I have a tool that does some flagging, and if it goes under a threshold, like it's really hard to do this show, because it's hard to get enough content, and because I'll be like, oh, and last week, what did we say? It was flat, and this week it's flat again. Like no volatility equals no show. So we'd go into hiatus at episode 100 anyway. The fact that we don't have that content generator coming into the summer really bums me out. And I just don't. I just don't see a ton of stuff for me as a marketeer to do what I want to do. 'Cause like the thing I get the biggest gains out of in Eve is that I don't really care about space money, right? Like I hit my wealthy enough cap years ago, even before I started doing the show. And like Isk really doesn't have value for what I want to do. What is valuable is being able to make other players wealthy, to be able to teach you guys what to do or to automate tools so that it's easier for you to make money, for so that you can go out and get more shit blown up. My best days in Eve are ones where I can make somebody else rich. But like to be honest, getting that profit endpoint is most of what I wanted to do. The other big chunk is getting our data served out to the rest of you, but I really want to put it in Mongo first. The way that it's piped around right now totally sucks. I hate our V1 pipeline. I'm happy to go send out figure out a way to host just raw dumps for people to download, but the ability to share that, like, so I work at a security firm now, and opening up a database to the world terrifies me. Like the Prosper API is set up, it runs completely headless. So I can put it in a little VM container, and it doesn't have credentials to jack shit, and it can just run and no big deal. Like you can deploy Prosper API on your own machine. If you don't like my API thing, you can install it on your own Ubuntu system and run it to your heart's content. It is set to be reasonably well easy to containerize, but it means I have no credentials. Like you can't go and magically delete my stuff because I forgot to scrub a key from GitHub, or you can't escape out of the Flask container and go steal credentials because there are no credentials on the box to steal. So, sharing databases terrifies me, and I only recently figured out how to get the REST thing running well. Once I get over to Mongo, I'm hoping that writing a REST endpoint to query that will be pretty easy peasy. I already have a cookie cutter set up so you can make a new Prosper project pretty quickly and have all of our magic boilerplate already done. I think it's like 90% done. But yeah, but like that amount of horsepower, the amount of horsepower I want to unleash. I don't mean to make this sound like jerky, so please forgive me. I don't mean this in any sort of condescending way, but like the horsepower I'm pointing towards Eve and the amount of code effort that's going into this show is like halfway to making a new com to making a real life new company. And if I can crack the nut of data science pipelining, like that opens the door to consultancy, that opens up the door to real life market trading, that opens up the door to even opens up the door to be able to do stuff more in the vein of 538 if I were so inclined. And it to be honest, like Eve is the only MMO worth doing that much work for, but but it's like I was talking to Mr. Stratz actually over lunch today, and I mentioned that Eve is an incredible resource as a developer to get free, well-documented, well-behaved APIs, and it's a great place to cut your teeth. And I still intend to cut code like it's going to go to Eve, because that gives me a springboard for GitHub projects to say, look, you can run it. You don't need special keys for anything. The data is free and public and open. You guys get use out of it. There's still a lot of devs out there or aspiring devs who'd like to do, who'd like to contribute. And if I do enough cookie cutters and stuff, we can leverage that sort of like, hey, I've always wanted to learn how to blank, and be able to leverage some of that, whether that's towards Eve or towards something bigger. But like the talent pool at Eve is just so deep and so open that it's like that's the big thing that's been keeping me tied in, is that the dev fleet is just such an amazing and incredible resource that you can go call up people like and there's so many people making so many cool projects, and there's so many people wanting to go from, I don't know anything, you can have all these people who don't know anything about code, and I like, how many times have you seen a presentation that's like, I didn't know jack shit, but then I learned spreadsheets thanks to Eve, and now I'm a manager at whatever, and I'm making twice as much as I did. There are so many rungs on that particular ladder, from, oh, I was doing spreadsheets and now I learned to really code, or now I learned to go from a hacktastic piece of shit to real pro dev, or like there's everyone up the whole thing. And I mean, I've walked that line from I can barely code my way out of a wet paper sack to moderately proficient Pythonista over the course of like 5 years. And it's thanks to Eve that I got here. And I feel like I owe those groups dividends for the work that they gave me, and the time and the energy that community turned into my real job. I got my real job thanks to this show. And yeah, so the thing is that I want, like, there are bigger mountains to climb for me. And if you enjoy the graph porn, if you enjoy the dev stuff, if you want to see shiny data and you want to go learn new things, keep learning new things, then we'll be back eventually. I'm not sure exactly when, but I just can't promise it'll be Eve anymore. But like, the thing I'm sort of jazzed to do is say, well, Robinhood doesn't have trading fees and has an open API. We've just released a market predictor robot that is performing moderately well. So what if we took the technical analysis chops up to now and tried to go put them on the real life market? What could we learn? Like, maybe it's not worth it because of the fucking accounting, but Like we could grow the community even further than we have. So there'll be news. There still will be tools. Do get subscribed to the stuff. But I can't keep an Eve. Like I can't keep up with the metas anymore. I can't keep up with who's fighting who. I've burned out all of my old romping grounds. I'm space homeless and I just do not enjoy the gameplay loop anymore. But this is a me problem. I've been playing for 12 years. Like that's why wouldn't I be? And I mean, nobody really truly quits Eve, and I'm not going to go here and be like, ah, F you guys, I'm going to get out of here. This game is dumb. I hate everything. And if you like Eve, you're dumb too. I'd never do that, but we gotta leave space for the next generation. Rodan is doing great work, doing his technical analysis streams on Tuesday nights. Christopher Mellon is doing his Minor Metrics show several times a week. That is like a little tiny bite-sized version of this show. If Mr. Stratz ever comes back, he was doing TA. Like there are so many, there's so many new voices coming up, and I really desperately hate when I hear that, well, why would I start a new show when there's the Eve Prosper show? Like I can't beat Lockfox. Like, it's not about beating anyone. Like, it's about serving the niche. And so what if between DeLone Wolf and I, we make up the biggest pieces of the pie? Like, there's still so many people who may not like my presentation style or want to get into more, get into deeper pieces of the stuff. Maybe they want to do deeper technical analysis. Maybe they're just looking for the guy who tells them what to buy and what to sell, because I rather purposely don't give you specific buy orders except for when it's really obvious. Maybe that you really enjoy the 5,000 ISK challenge, or maybe I'm not talking enough about Null, or I don't talk about wormholes like at all. These are all total spaces that that are completely poorly served, and somebody else could make that show. So this is your chance. The giant is leaving. I'm abdicating my throne. Go and make your own thing. So there's so many excellent market people in the meta, and I think it's time for some new shows. It is time for some new shows. So this is your 5-minute warning. I'm going to wrap up the show here pretty soon. I'm going to need to get out of here, get a big drink of water. Mine has gone empty. Do join the Discord again. If you have anything you want to talk to me about, that's the very best place to get in touch with me. There is a lot of DevFleet spam in there. If you're at all interested in the development side, again, I'm more than happy to answer questions, even the dumb ones. Like I said, I have passion for this part of the game, and I want to teach you to be excellent. I want everybody else to make tons of money. Like my best days are when I get something about, like, I've only got this a couple of times. Okay, so my second best days are when I get an email. It's like, oh, I did your thing and I made a truckload of money. Thanks for your show. And there's so many of those shows that so many of those emails that really mean a lot to me. So, go out, make a ton of money. And even if I'm wrong, that's my one failure for this show. If there's one thing I can say that I failed at on this show, is that I haven't made anyone space destitute. Like, You think that I'd be sitting here and telling you guys week after week for 2.5 years, buy this, sell that, do this, do that, that somebody would have gone and jumped in both feet and been like, I lost my fucking shirt on your stupid thing, and now I'm space destitute. I was really I like that. That is my number one accolade that I have not received. If I could go get the hate mail. The other one was like, and so maybe now that I have the prophet endpoint out there and there's a robot generating predictions, someone will go make a jump on something dumb. because come on, guys, at the end of the day, it's fake money. It's real time. But it's Eve. Why, like, you should be scamming people for your money, and you should be stealing stuff from corpse and living it up in space rather than playing space accountant because you didn't get enough of it at work. Like, but I guess people play Dwarf Fortress, so I can't judge. It's all just fake money at the end of the day, and ISK is so freaking cheap. The price of Plex tells you that the price of money of ISK is just not even pocket change. It's barely couch money when you break it all down. But go jump in and do it. Like, the worst that can happen is you lose a billion ISK, right? And I know for a lot of the guys out there that, especially if you're new or if you're an alpha, a billion ISK sounds like a ton of money, right? And you're right. I get the sort of shock factor there. But, like, let's be honest here. How hard is it to generate a billion ISK? You can get to a billion ISK on 5,000 ISK in like 14 days if you're trading. You can go mine to a billion ISK. You can go pick out the dregs off of ratters for a billion ISK. Like, when you really get dig down into it, it's not it's it sounds like a lot, especially if you haven't got your first billion yet. Like, it's a big milestone. I understand. But, like, how many hours of incursion ratting does that really cost? How many hours of nullsec ratting does that cost? How many hours of level 4 mission running? Okay, a lot. That one sucks. What about faction warfare loyalty points? What about mining in something better than a frigate? What about wormhole loot? What about stealing wrecks? What about corporate espionage and stealing somebody else's money, because the best money in the world is somebody else's money. So, like, at the end of the day, for most of the game, a billion ISK is a unit, but it's still small. And the higher the price of Plex goes, the less that individual ISK really costs. And if you lose 100 million ISK, like, what is that? A couple of bucks? Like, that's not even a coffee. Like, go. To be honest, my best stories are the ones that I lost in, not the ones that I won. And okay, so Solomon's asking a very good question in YouTube that, going from 1 billion to 10 billion to 100 billion, each of those steps turns into a completely different game. And that you're right about. Getting to 10 billion is kind of a pain in the butt because, like, so the way I like to think of it personally is that a lot of the money making apparatuses I have advocated for people, like when I've trained people to do things, or when I've designed systems that I expect players to take over. I usually think in 1 billion ISK per character units. So, like, doing high-end PI, that's maybe 2 billion startup. Low end is less than a billion. The Fitted ship trade. That's anywhere from 2 to 5 billion, and there's actually a lot more on the bottom end of that that you can squeeze in on. But like trying to get above that 5 billion unit mark requires some specialty, where like it's easy to, for instance, to put 4 billion or 5 billion in a cross market arbitrage scheme where you're buying buy orders in JIDA and you're shipping them to Amar, you're shipping them to Dixie, getting like 5 billion into that regime, not that hard. But getting to 10 billion with that starts to look like work. You start thinking, well, maybe I should add another market on there. Well, now I need to put another character somewhere. Okay, maybe I need to be working on my contracting so I'm not shipping everything. Okay, maybe that gets me to 12 billion. But like trying to get above that 10 billion mark starts to mean that you really have to specialize. Like you start talking about multiple characters, you start talking about heavier equipment. Like I really love industry, for instance. That's a great way to get to like the 50 billion operating purse. But I had to do that with a lot of characters. I had like 7 characters running on a 50 billion-esque purse. Capital production requires a big upfront investment, but is a great way to push a lot of money through for a fixed margin. As you start getting into nullsec supply, there's some great stuff there to get above the 20 billion mark. But like we're really talking about specialty businesses then. And it's really, you really start looking at like, do I multi-box? Do I get heavier equipment? Do I go drop a Ritaru, or do I get a super for ratting, or do I need to get my corp into a higher class wormhole? Like these start looking, going from casual, like being able to leverage 5 to 10 billion is kind of casual thing, is reasonably easy. But then you want to get above 10, you really got to start thinking something specialty, and like high grade wormholes will get you there. High grade industry will get you there. High grade nullsec trade will get you there. But it's not as turnkey. It's not as casual. It becomes a much larger piece of your operating pie, of your time in game. And well, personally, I've tried to in the last few years, I've really tried to limit the amount of hours I'm making ISK. Because I'd rather be using ISK. Like PvP is more fun than 0-1 ISKing. They're being in fleets with people is way more fun than mining rocks. This is a personally me thing, and I'm of an age and an income bracket that I'd rather buy Plex than grind cash. So. Well, and again, the 0-1 ISK thing actually comes back to you build your strategy to avoid the pain. You aim for higher margins so you don't end up eating losses and having to care a lot about a lot of active management. And you manage your volumes to avoid 0-1 ISKing, because if you as soon as you cross certain volume thresholds, you have to play the 0-1 ISK game, because you have to get to the head of the line to get washed out of your ISK. And like if you're 5% of the orders, well, you can be in and out pretty quick. But if you're 20% of the orders, holy shit, you have to be there at the front of the line over and over and over again to actually get paid. So like you balance against the game rather than complain that the game's not doing it the way you want it to. And so those are my two biggest hints when it comes to doing it. Try to get as big a margin as you can for as much money as you can put through. And it's not just percent margin. Do remember net margin is a thing. And so you'll need to make a transition from when you're going from space poor and you need high percentage margin. You're willing to do the bigger risk, the bigger effort thing to get high percentage margin because you just don't have the cash, to the advanced thing where you say, well, I can live with 10% margin or 8% margin because I'm going to make it up in the number of units sold. And at the end of the day, I'm going to make 10 times more cash than I would have on that low mar on that high margin, low volume item. So it ends up being a balancing act. The second part is that you play with volume and you look really hard at the volume stats so that you're only having to come in and manage the trades on your time, and you can be washed out of the system while some other asshole with who's taking up, 10% of the orders has to fight to get his money. You're already paid. You already have your money in hand, and you can move on to the next thing. So, like the idea that you got to be active market PvP all the time, and you have to be there like a fucking human. You have to be a mechanical Turk there, 0-1-isking till you go dead. Like, that's doing it wrong. To be honest, that is the wrong way to approach it because you should have been paid already. Like if you're doing all that time, you are making terrible money for the effort expelled. What you should be doing is you have a bunch of little orders that, onesie twosie get filled, or if you're trading in, if you were trading in like Tritanium, yeah, you need million-esque units, a million units or 10 million units. But you start talking about those 100 million unit orders, well, now you're stuck in 0-1-isking land, and now you're stuck in fighting land. Like, same for like if you went into the Ishtar market, if you're selling like 5 or 10 of those, easy peasy. You're in, you're out on the weekend. Like, you update your orders, you deal with it on your time. It takes like 5 minutes and you're paid. If you're doing 200 units, holy shit, you got to be there every fucking day. You got to be updating your thing like before you go to work and when you come home from work and then before you go to bed to make sure that you're at the front of the queue every fucking time. So, like, why not spread the load a little bit wider and say, okay, well, I'm going to show up once a day or twice a day, and I'm going to spread across a lot of different markets in lower volumes, and then I get paid and I'm done and I'm out of that market because I controlled my volumes. And that's how you fight 0-1-isking. You don't play that game. Like, you don't get stuck in the trap like everybody else. You work around it, and you can count your money at home while everyone else is gnashing their teeth in Jita about G having to fight robots. And it's the same for buy orders, especially. Like, the thing I can't seem to get people to understand is that if you're playing buy orders, you really shouldn't be playing at the front of the queue. Like, if you're playing on buy orders and you're at the front of the queue, like, that is a high effort regime. And unless the margins are just astronomical, it's not worth your time. Instead, you go and you look at the stats and you say, well, we're at this today, and we're looking at the buy depth to the next rung. You know what? I'm going to put my order between the rung today and the next big set of orders so that if the price falls, I catch orders on the fall. That way, you may not get the whole thing filled, and it may still require some active management. But this way, you just sit on your order waiting for the fish to come to you, rather than sitting here every fucking day and going, like, give me onesie twosie orders for, one isk there and one isk there. Like, play smarter, not harder. Well, I know Marsha, you know how to do it. Of course you know how to do it. But a lot of my audience doesn't. I don't think a lot of the newbies really understand that there's other depths you can play at to sort of mess with that. And like, if you're messing with the margin, you're messing with speculation, you can do the same thing on sell orders. It's a little bit harder, but you can play just outside of the bands and jump up And when it jumps up, you get bought out on the way up, or if it jumps down, you get bought out on the way, you get sold in on the way down. You play in the bands rather than on the edges, and like industrialists should probably be playing on the edges. Like, you need to get paid. You just need to run lean on ISK and not run a whole bunch of fucking stockpile. You need to just get paid, right? If you're an industrialist, this is a little bit different for you. But if you're a station trader, you should be watching the bands to say, I want to get paid when it comes up through me or falls down through me. I don't really need to play right there on the edges. There are places, you know, exceptions to every rule. If there's enough margin in the thing, like, why the heck not? You know, there are a thousand markets that will prove me wrong on this case. So this is just a rule of thumb. But like, if you're playing in the big markets and the heavy markets, like one of the ones that I made margin hand over fist doing this, was that I was playing in the advanced moon material market, and I would put opportunistic buy orders in JETA, waiting for the volatility to just pass through me so I could buy stuff. I'd then ship it out to JETA, out to Amar or Dodixie, and I would just lay the order in. I'd do maybe one pass at managing it a day just to make sure that I was in the line. And yeah, a bunch of people would go and fuck with the market in the meantime. So this was a kind of a slow process, but I ended up making like 20% margin on the work because I was getting useful buy, getting good buy orders on the way in. I was getting good buy orders on the sell out. I was automating as much as you can in the game my logistics by using Red Frog and Pushax Freight to move it between places. Like, I wasn't trying to get paid on the day, and like, it definitely capped out on exactly how much I could get through the system. So like, I could only really put 2 or 3 billion ISK in the system. So like, this is not a get rich quick scheme for everyone, but like, the thing I ended up playing the most was the meta materials have so much margin in the buy to sell spread and so much volatility week to week that since I was moving slower than the average market, slower than the average spreadsheet warrior, and I was taking a couple of days between buys and sells and playing more in the spread than on the edge, I was able to make my 20%. The experiment that I was trying to do failed because I was trying to amp supplies so that like the net trade inside like Amar would rise because it was easier for Tech 2 producers to be there, and like I had this idea, it didn't work out. But like playing in things like the metamaterials and playing in things like fullerides and nanotransistors, which have more volatility in them, I was able to coast in the middle and sort of just play on the edge. So it took time to get everything washed through, and it wasn't the easiest thing to do, and there was still leftover material when you were done, so it was a little bit more accounting than I think a lot of people are prepared to do. But you know, sign up for Eve Mogul, let them do the accounting for you. Again, like I said, it was watch the margin and buy one day, have it shipped the next day, sell it on the next day that it got there. Let some of the volatility play itself out and drop those market orders when people do something really stupid, and wait for it to come back. The volatility played in my favor. So the expected noise day to day and week to week was in such a way that having a little bit of patience ended up making this a money-making venture. But it wasn't inherently obvious it took a little bit of patience, but I was making money. And for instance, one of the other experiments I did back then when I did it was that I was building up CDFs for I was building up Q plots, which tell how likely an price was, told you the percentiles for everything. So I took the day-to-day margin on like faction battleships or minerals, for instance, and I would do a percentile calculation to say, what's the median margin in a month on this thing. And then you could cut this plot up into quadrants and say, well, okay, so like Morphite, for instance, was really great. If you were buying buy orders in Jita and you were selling to sell orders in Dodixie, your median margin was something like 9%. And on a bad day, your 25 percentile was down at like 5%, and your Q75 was up at like 12%, which meant that if I buy in, and no matter what happens, if I buy in and I shipped it today, I would most of the time, 80 something percent of the time, make 5 to 11% margin automatically, just by the pure math. I could make that margin. And if I went ahead and was smarter about it and played some of the buy order, look for low buy orders and look for high sell orders and played some of the extra margin, I could add like 2 percentage points on either side of that if I was being good at it. So that means we basically say 85% of the time I'm making 7 to 15% automatically, and as long as I don't fuck up the volumes, I'd be making money. But like the analysis to do that was a pain in the ass, and nobody else understood the charts I was making, so I put it away. Crash the markets I would start in. I'm a big fan of the Faction Warfare loyalty point stores are a pretty easy one, but that one might take some time to get money washed out of. I also like PvP items is a great one to ship around, where you're taking things like ballistic control units and stasis web of fires and prop mods and all that other stuff, all that sort of like bread and butter daily stuff. Tech two, if you can, tech two would be better than tech one. And you move that around when the margins tell you to. That's definitely not a bad living. I like the moon markets, but right now it's a really dangerous place to be playing in. It's not what it used to be the last time I was in it. The other one, if you're talking 4 to 5 billion, I like the thing that I spent 4 to 5 billion on, and I was getting 20% margin on, was fitted ship contracts. But that's because I was a director and it was a captive market. And I told them to suck it the fuck up, and you're paying the margin because it's push button receive bacon. I also built a Skookum spreadsheet to help me make that as easy as possible. But it also means you need to have access to jump freight to be able to do it. Like, if you have access to something on the frontier, if you're in a NullSec alliance, wormhole group, LowSec group, faction warfare, there's a lot of little great stuff for doing convenience work for people that make that, like, there's a whole bunch of people out there who just want a PvP and don't give a shit, and you can make a lot of money off of them because they need bullets and they need guns and they need ships. And jump freight is the easiest thing to do. Hub supply is a harder thing to do. It's a lot easier to do if you are in the group that needs the supply. It's a lot harder to do from the outside looking in. You need to do a little bit more statistics grabbing to really know what to buy. But like I'm saying, this is you'd be supplying for your group. You're not going to go out as a solo guy with 4 to 5 billion and expect to feed VFK or some major thing. You're going to go and take 1 to 4 billion and make sure that your guys have the ships that they use every day, or make sure that they have the bullets they have, or you're going to buy up rig materials on the cheap, ship it out, get it built, and build them. Like, you're going to use that competitive advantage and make money off the fact that people are lazy. Like, that's the easiest thing to do. Yeah, I said it was five. We were at the 5 minute warning 15 minutes ago. I do need to get off the air. I want to thank everybody who tuned in and enjoyed the show. Thank you for the excellent trolling, Marsha. You should show up for more of the shows. Do join the Prosper Discord. Links to join are down and below. If I didn't get to your question, or I did a shitty job answering it, again, Discord's the best place to get in touch with me. And we'll be back next week, same bat time, same bat channel. And do if you missed anything, the whole thing will be up on YouTube in like 5 minutes. So, ciao, guys. Fly safe. Make all the money.